alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Hello and welcome to our series, Islamic Finance. This is episode number 6. We talked about the concepts of economics in Islam, the components of the financial deals in our religion, the principles that guide Islam's view on the issue. We talked about Islamic banking versus the traditional banking, and the fact that Islamic banking concentrates on real risk management, on mudaraba and murabaha and not interest, and focuses on real guarantees when it gives you loans, and focuses on production, loans for production rather than loans for consumption, and much more. And here in this episode with Sheikh Shady Al-Suleiman from Sydney, Australia, researcher in the field of Islamic economics, we're going to be talking more about Islamic financing and how we as individuals can benefit from Islamic banks to buy a house, to buy a car, to have our own small enterprise or project, and what happens in the case of default, and what are the duties rights of each party here. Sheikh Shady, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Thank you for your insight so far. Looking to, forward to hear more from you. And here we're talking about, you know, financing for individuals. I want to buy a house. I want to buy a car. And you're telling me don't go to the banks because they give interest and this is haram. And sometimes you're going to tell me don't even go to the Islamic bank because they don't work according to Sharia. And this might be the case in many cases. And sometimes Muslims are so confused because they hear some of their scholars say that even the non-traditional system of banking is halal. So what shall we do?
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, alhamdulillah, wa salatu wa salam ala Rasulullah. Brother Muhammad, you mentioned very, very good points here. And inshallah, we'll take point by point. Now, obviously, in Western world, Muslims who live in the Western world, they have it a lot more harder and a lot more tougher in the Muslim world, in the non-Muslim world than what they have in a Muslim world. A lot of the Muslims live in the Muslim world, maybe they do have that facility of trying to finance themselves through an Islamic bank, through an acceptable mean, or an acceptable way of that pleases Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the Sharia. One of the things that really impressed me is how a bank will buy a complex or build a complex, and then they start selling those complexes to people over a period of 20 years. And that's the most common one that you have these days. And that's a very good idea, which there is no doubt in it, if it's done, of course, in accordance to the Sharia way. The bank owns it and the bank sells it. Now, the common way that you find people when they want to buy a house, for example, or buy a car, or buy whatever they want to buy, they will go to the bank. They will go to the bank. And they want $100,000 to buy this house. So what the bank does, the bank gives them $100,000. So what did the bank do? The bank gave them money. In return, that they pay back that money to the bank with an extra at the top.
Mm.
So this is riba.
Mm.
This is riba.
Mm.
There's difference between if the bank owns that house and says, look, I want to sell you that house of $500,000 in a period of 25 years. There's nothing wrong with that. Why? Because what you've exchanged with the bank is that you bought a house with money. But the common thing is that you take money and you return money. So you've taken $100,000 from the bank and you've returned to the bank $150,000 in a period of 25 years or 20 years or whatever number of years that you've done. This is where riba is.
Mm.
This is haram.
Mm.
If I take $100,000, I must give back $100,000. Mm. Regardless, even if it's after 20 years.
Right.
Some people even come up with the question, say, but the value of the $100,000,
the inflation,
yeah,
so
20
on.
Years ago, is not the value of it right now. The value of it now is probably $500,000 still. That's not an argument.
So the idea is in the fixed pricing and
as the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, gold with gold, silver with silver. Okay, but if the exchange is different, I'm buying a house with money, then it doesn't matter how
exactly
expensive or how much I pay for that house. Now the best way is that the bank owns that. We mentioned before the murabaha. That's the best, easiest, simplest. Okay, I'm interested in buying a house. I'm interested in buying a car. I go to the bank buys the house, the bank buys the car, and then they sell it to me with an extra cost, with an extra profit, over a period of 10 years or 15 years or whatever agreement we agree, and I put the house or the car as a guarantee that if I can't pay this amount of money that they paid for, they'll take the house or take or sell the house or sell the car, and then they take the profit and give me back whatever is left. So this is the easiest way.
Indeed.
There's other forms. The other form is musharaka, and that's also common amongst the Islamic banks, where, for example, I want to buy this house. And I've got the house is worth $100,000 and I've got $20,000. So I come to the bank. What does the bank give me? They give me the offer of going as partners into this house. So I pay $20,000 and they pay $80,000.
So I own 20% of the house.
I own 20% of the house and the bank owns?
80.
Okay. Now what happens? Who's the owner of the house? It's a partnership.
It's a partnership.
20-80.
Exactly.
And the partnership... When Islam comes partnership, when Islam talks about partnership, partners must take fair and equal just responsibility over what they are partnering. So I'm 20%, I must take responsibility 20% of everything.
Exactly.
Okay. And what the bank does is that you and the bank now are partners in this house, and what Islamic banks mostly do, then they give you the chance to start buying their share over a period of 20 years. But where the downfall is of some Islamic banks that we've experienced in the West, they are your partners, but they don't take any responsibility as being partners. Mm. You pay, like for example, in Australia, we have something called stamp duty. When you buy a house, you pay tax. The bank tells you, you pay the tax. Well, you are my partner. You should be also
paying
tax.
You should pay 80% of the stamp.
Yeah, so don't tell me we are partners in one area,
right,
not partners in another area. Okay, yeah. If there is something happens to the house, then you are also my partner.
Mm.
Okay, so the musharaka is another common thing that happens with the Islamic banks, that they go in with you, they enter with you a contract as they are your partners, take full responsibility as your partners, and also, you, if you're going to live in that house, you'll be paying your partner rent.
Mm.
Because if I am the bank, I've got 80% share in this house, and you've got 20%, and we've got this house, and we rent this house for $200 a week.
Mm.
Then I've got the rights to get $160 a week.
Exactly.
So what the Islamic bank, he tells you, look, you pay me $160 a week rent because...
That's 80% of the fair value of the weekly.
The other 20%, that's your business, what you do with
yourself.
It. You pay yourself. You get it off someone who rents the house. That's but at the end of the day, I'm a partner. So what the bank gets, they get the rent, and also they give you the chance to buy a share.
Mm.
Every year, for example, buy 5%.
Mm.
And then you become 25% owner.
And they are the ones that define the share they will give you?
Yeah, this is something that you agree with them morally.
Okay.
Okay. And the bank accepts that because it's their interest. So year by year, you start buying a percentage from them.
And in the middle, you can both parties could agree to, you know, accelerate or decelerate.
Of course, that's the rights.
Right.
That's the rights of partnership.
Mm.
That's the rights of partnership. Mm. So this is one form. Now,
and this
obviously,
is acceptable.
Of course, it's acceptable.
It's a bay'ah.
It's simple.
It's a bay'ah.
No, it's musharaka.
It's musharaka.
Partnership.
Partnership.
Okay? Partnership that me and the bank went into, me as the customer and the bank as the financial holder has got the money. We went together as partners buying this property and then dealing as partners, like a partnership, and slowly I start buying my share because what's my problem? My problem is... It's not that I don't have the money. I have the money, but I need 20 years to get it.
Exactly.
So I'm getting paid wages every year, and I need to
so
pay
So what
the
happens
money.
In the case of death, then?
Okay, in case of death, obviously the partnership breaks, and it goes to the heirs, the inheritors, those who inherit. Mm. But obviously,
what if the inheritance can't...
Then they break the partnership, and
they get what they've paid.
The portion of their father or
right.
whoever okay. they inherit goes back into the mirath.
Mm.
Yeah, so this is a simple way. But I want to mention something. Like, I come from Australia, for example. What's sometimes a problem that the actual legislation, the state legislation or the government legislation does not facilitate that freedom for you to do those things sometimes.
Mm.
You know, this is one of the problems that you find in the Western countries. Even though the Islamic banks want to implement that, but the actual legislation of the country, the constitution...
We've seen some governments that want, you know, more elements of Islamic banking in their countries, but parliaments, indeed, in those countries, preventing that. We've seen, like France, for instance.
Now, Australia is one of those who are very, very eager into introducing Islamic finance into the country.
Mm.
And they've changed some of their legislations to be fit.
So Parliament has acted.
Yes,
acted, unlike France, by the way.
They did change some of the legislations on constitution
to fit,
and they still need to do more. Mm. But as I mentioned, sometimes it's not easy to do within Western countries or maybe even Muslim countries due to the economical legislations that have in the government that does not allow them to do those things.
Mm-hmm. You've just talked about financing a house. I guess if I'm an individual, I want to buy a car. The same would can easily go for the car.
Murabaha is one,
right?
Okay, that I'm interested in this car. The bank buys it for $10,000, sell it to me for $15,000 over a period of 5 years. That's murabaha.
Right.
Or go as partnerships. I pay $1,000, they pay $9,000, so I earn 10%. They earn 90%, but we go in as partners,
right.
And then slowly I start buying my share from the bank. Obviously, sounds easy, but there are some areas where, when I say, when it comes to partnership, we are partners.
Mm.
So you also are liable for all the losses and the profits.
Exactly.
Yeah, where sometimes some banks say, look, we are partners, but if there's a loss, you're the only one that loses.
Mm.
And that's where you find this is a big gap in the Islamic Sharia that does not accept that. Mm. We are partners, we are responsible.
Again, that's exploitation.
Yeah.
And that would be darar.
Yes. You don't bring harm. If we win, we both win. If we lose, we both lose.
Exactly. Now, what if I'm the borrower? I have an idea, great idea, a small project that wouldn't cost much, but I don't have the money. So I borrow from the bank. I give them the plan or the budget study. And in that case, they can go in as partners with me.
Okay, you've got two ways. Hmm. If I want to finance a project, or I want to finance an investment, you've got two ways. Either partnership, which means I have to put in some money, or mudaraba.
Hmm.
Okay, partnership, that I want to invest in this big complex, is going to cost $1 million. I'll probably have $100,000. Okay, then the bank puts in $900,000, and we are both partners into this complex, into this project.
Mm.
So at the end of the day, the profit, 90% is going to go to whom?
To the 900,000.
It's going to go to the bank.
Mm.
And 10% will come back to me because we are partners.
Mm.
Or go as mudaraba.
Mm.
Mudaraba means I don't go in with my money, I go in with my talent. I need to build this project for $1 million. The bank gives me $1 million. I do not put in a cent.
Mm.
See, this is the difference between musharaka and mudaraba.
Mm.
Musharaka is that both parties put in money.
Mm.
Mudaraba means one party puts in the money and the other party puts in its talent and experience.
And the talent could be this party or that party, the bank or the individual or the institution.
If I want to invest into a big project, obviously it's going to be the bank that's going to be putting the money.
Right.
So the bank will put in the money and then I invest that money. And
right.
But we have to agree on
the
percentage.
And as a depositor in that Islamic bank, I should be knowing which project my money is being used in.
When it comes to mudaraba, if I am investing my money with you, you have to be very clear to me. We have to agree on two main things. Number one is the percentage of profit. And number two is you must be very clear to me where you're going to use this money. So if you're going to say, I'm going to invest this money into building, then you cannot go and buy clothing with it or go to China You have to be very clear.
All right. Clear again. We'll be taking a break here, and we'll be back for the second part of our episode with Sheikh Shady Al-Suleiman in a very short while. Stay with us.
Hopefully we'll discuss some tips on how to increase the ability of getting the dua or the supplication answered.
Allah delays giving you what you want and gives you a reward that is equal to that or better in this life or in the world to come, forgiving your sins and giving you good deeds.
I'm going to look at some questions that we've asked some of our brothers on the street. We asked them, should Muslims have a dialogue with other religions?
We're going to need some stability.
So it doesn't matter where we live, we need to care for those ones to give them the rights that Allah gives.
This life is not the eternal life. It is a test.
Particularly for the youth of today. So if there are any parents or uncles or whoever is watching, if you have 16, 17, 18, 20-year-olds with you, make sure they stop doing whatever they're doing and come in and watch this show, inshallah.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Once again, Sheikh Shadi talking about the means of financing in Islamic banking and how can individuals and banks profit together and invest together.
You brought up a point that someone wants to invest. And you know, most of the times you've got the builders or businessmen who have the talent, have the ideas, have the contacts, have the connections, have the knowledge, but they don't have the money.
Exactly.
Okay, as I mentioned, they could go in as partners with the bank, and both, that means that the customer must provide some money, whatever amount of money that is. Or they go in as mudaraba, which means they take the money from the bank and they invest that money into that property. But there's two main things that must agree with the bank. Is number one, that they must agree on the profit, on the percentage of the profit. That means that could be anything in agreement. Could be 10% to 90%, could be 50 to 50, whatever they agree. And the second thing is that this customer must be clear to the bank or to the investor that's investing the money exactly what they're investing the money in. And he's not allowed to do with that money
anything else than
what he had agreed. So for example, if he agreed with the bank that he's going to invest $1 million into property, then he must invest into property. He can't go and do business with it. And thirdly, of course, if there's a loss, it's on both, which means he lost his talent. He can't say, well, I want money for my talent. And the time that he's put into that, and the labor work that he's put, and the bank also loses the money. So this is one form which is called mudaraba.
And usually they would agree on the sharing of the burden of the loss percentages as well.
Supposedly,
there is a loss, we have to share it together. The loss.
If it's mudaraba, it's only one party that invested the money. The other one only invested talent. So there's nothing for him to lose. Okay, but if it's musharaka, then both. Both will lose in accordance to their percentage.
Does the percentage of the division of the percentages in the case of a profit, does it have to be the same division in the case of a loss? Or is it
musharaka, they both lose and they both win according to their percentage. So if they win, with the percentage, like if I've got 90%, I'll take 9% of the profit. If I've got 10%, I'll take 10%. If we lose, I'll lose 10%, and the other one loses 90%. But with mudaraba, you only have one party investing money. The other one is not investing money; they're investing their talent. So if they lose the money, then it's going to be the bank that's going to lose the money, not the person who was using that money to buy and sell or to do that project. And if they make a profit, then the profit will get into percentage according to the agreement from the beginning, where the one who invested the money will take a percentage of, or take a certain amount of money from the percentage, and the other one who dealt with the money will also take a percentage. This is mudaraba. Or they could do wakala, and which means a commission, which means that the bank will assign someone to do a job on their behalf. So the wakil will be more of an employee, or more of a contractor, an agent, which that's obviously, there's not much benefit for the agent to make much money on that. It's like he's more of an employee than anything else. But the most two common one is a sharaka, partnership, or mudaraba. That's the best way you could finance someone who is in need of money. So that, like he's a bank financing someone who is in need of money to do a certain project or a business and so on. And obviously, we have this common problem that you have a lot of good Muslim businessmen, but the only reason they're not producing and not developing or not growing is because they don't have the money, they don't have the capital. And the only way they could get that capital is from the bank. But the bank gives you money and you have to return back that money with an extra at the top. And obviously, it's not acceptable because that's riba. And some people say, but you know, I will use that for the good, and I'll, you know, become rich and start investing and start donating to the mosque. Again, we do mention the qa'ida, al-ghaya la tubarru wasila. You cannot use a haram mean to get to halal.
See, Muslims are confused, Sheikh, because some have heard fatwas saying that the traditional way of nowadays banking is halal, and others have heard fatwas that even the Islamic banks are haram. So they are really confused.
There's no doubt not all Islamic banks are in accordance to the Sharia. Okay? It doesn't mean that if a bank puts a banner or a sign in front of the bank saying it's an Islamic bank, it means an Islamic bank. There's a lot of Islamic banks. There's a lot of banks out there that claim to be Islamic and according to the Sharia that are very far away from the Islamic banks. I've experienced some banks, okay, they call themselves Islamic banks, Sharia compliant banks, and all they do is get money from the banks and give it to you. So what did you do here? You've just been a middleman getting money from the bank and giving it to me. You've got some banks who are trying to do their best, but obviously, as I said, the regulations of the government, legislation and the law sometimes makes it hard on them.
Are Muslim governments, are governments of Muslim countries encouraging Islamic banking, or do you think that, you know, they are not giving it enough attention?
There are some countries who are leading the world with Islamic finance, such as Malaysia, such as Bahrain, for example, Dubai or
Saudi
Emirates,
UAE.
Like, these are one of the leading countries when it comes to Islamic finance, and they are working and promoting that. One of the common things that you realize that if you calculate at the end of the day, when you take money from the Islamic banks or the normal bank, you end up being paying extra more with the Islamic bank than a normal bank. And a lot of people use that as an excuse, saying, why should I go through an Islamic bank when the normal bank down the road takes less, and at the end of the day, I'm paying $400,000 than $500,000 through the bank.
Right.
Well, that's still not an excuse.
Difference doesn't reach that much. Yeah, usually it's a difference of, you know, 7.5% or 7.75%.
Yeah, but if you calculate it in some Western countries, like where I come from,
I'm talking about here.
The difference is significant. You're talking about maybe $50,000 to $100,000 sometimes. But the difference is one is pleasing Allah, the other one is declaring one Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So I'd rather have patience in this world over what I go through than having patience in the hereafter. You know, the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum, when they used to leave their houses, their wives will say to them, please only bring what's halal to us. We'd rather starve in this world and have patience on that than having patience on the punishment of Allah.
Subhanallah.
So, you know, sometimes life, you know, it's not always that things should be so convenient and relaxing. Sometimes I need to struggle to please Allah Azza wa Jal. So I'd rather struggle through that than go through that. Another common one, like for example, sometimes, you know, renting, you know, you end up paying rent more than what if you're taking a mortgage or taking a loan, that you pay your payments or repay your payments. And this is a common one. I rent a house, I'm paying $2,000 a month for renting a house. If I buy this house, my payments to the bank will be $1,800. This is a common one. Then why should I, you know, as they say, I'm paying dead money to, you know, when I rent, when I could have my own house. Still, that's not an excuse. Yes, it makes sense in one way that, you know, you rather invest that money into a place that you know it's going to end up for you than that money going somewhere else. But still, that's not acceptable. Going back to what you mentioned about the fatawa.
Yes.
The fatawa and the
confused Muslims.
Yeah, and the rulings that many scholars at this time and era, I would not say many, but, you know, a fair number of them, which some of them are renowned scholars and prominent scholars that we know in Muslim world, gave the fatwa that you are allowed to deal with riba. And some of them even say the first house is acceptable. Some of them say the first house is acceptable. Well, I've spoken to some of those scholars. This difference between a scholar living amongst the West and knowing exactly what's happening than a scholar who's hearing about what's happening in the West. Some of the scholars are given the wrong information. Some of the scholars are told that we live on the streets and we've got nothing else, and the only way that we could have a shelter above our heads is by going through riba. This is what some of the scholars heard. So obviously the scholar looked at it from the point of darura. But the reality is, in the West, where I come from, there's no one that sleeps on the street. And you could still rent. You could still rent.
You know, the fatawas were not just for the West. There was also for here, for the Middle East.
I'm
so it was basically a fatwa. Some fatwas said the traditional way of nowadays banking is halal.
Yeah. So I'm talking about some of those scholars and those prominent scholars who mentioned that. But I know there's others who just said, you know, any form of riba or any form of bank, which is, of course...
Well, of course, they didn't say any form of riba. I mean, what they said...
Any form of any banking, get any traditional bank or any modern bank.
Maybe they calculated the inflation rate, or they saw that, you know, if you keep your money into the drawer, then it will be eaten up, or... Nobody knows where that came from, but it is confusing Muslims.
Yeah, it is, of course, when people start hearing that. But I still say, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He makes it very clear that riba is haram. We know that this is riba. It's very clear from its action. It's very clear from its content, and it's very clear from its name. And we should avoid that, regardless whether, you know, I'll be renting or moving a house every 6 months. At the end of the day, I'd rather struggle in this world and not displease Allah Azza wa Jal than displeasing Allah and going to the hellfire or getting punished. And this is not disrespecting any scholar or any sheikh or any imam who gave the fatwa that it is okay. But I still find it very, very hard to believe that this is an acceptable way that the Sharia would allow someone to deal with riba, because riba is evil, and Allah did not declare war on any haram the way He declared war on riba. And because it's so evil, we should not go near riba in any way or form.
Subhanallah. Right. I don't know. We only have 1 minute. I wanted to ask a question. I hope we'll try. We'll try. The guarantees again for the loans. I'm a regular person. I have a great idea. I'm sure it's going to succeed, but I don't have any guarantee. I go to the Islamic bank. What happens? Well, or the non-Islamic one? What
happens? Well, the guarantee is not a important or an integral part of the contract. That's up to the lender. Mm. If I'm lending you money, it's up to me to accept a guarantee or not. I could lend you money without guarantee. Mm. So it depends on the Islamic banks. Maybe you know, some Islamic banks would not ask you for a guarantee, but most of them will always want to reassure that you are able to pay that money back.
Maybe they could judge that the idea is in itself a guarantee. Yeah.
So the guarantee, the rahan, is not...
It could be an idea?
Yeah, I'm saying it could be, but the rahan, the guarantee, is not an integral part for the validity of the contract. I could give you money without a guarantee. Okay. I could give $500,000 and I'd not even ask you for a guarantee. Hmm. That's up to the lender.
That's huge risk.
Then that's up to the lender. Hmm. It's up to the bank or up to the lender for them to accept. But what's important is that we write that. As the Prophet, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says in the Quran al-Kareem, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا إِذَا تَدَيَّنْتُمْ بِدَيْنٍ إِلَىٰ أَجْلٍ مُسَمَّنْ فَاكْتُبُوا. All those who believe, if you take a loan to a certain period of time, then record it. It is important that when we take a loan, whether we lend to someone or borrow money, we record it and document it and get two people to witness that.
SubhanAllah. Sheikh Shady Al-Suleiman from Sydney, Australia, thank you very much, and looking forward, inshallah, to the upcoming episodes on the all-important issue of Islamic finance. Dear viewers, until we meet again, do stay with Huda TV. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.